برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. أما بعد، فالسلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. يقول الله العظيم في كتابه المحكم بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: لقد من الله على المؤمنين إذ بعث فيهم رسولا من أنفسهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة وإن كانوا من قبل لفي ضلال مبين. The ayah is known في سورة الأعراف. And the meaning of the ayah: لقد من الله على المؤمنين. Allah سبحانه وتعالى, the best meaning I can come up with is, has done the mu'mineen a great favor. What is this great favor? إِذْ بَعَثَ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ, that he sent to them a prophet from amongst themselves. يَتْلُو عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ, teaching them the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ, and he purifies their souls, he brings them to illumination. وَيُعَلِّمُهُمْ كِتَابَ الْحِكْمَةِ, and he teaches them the book and the wisdom. وَإِنْ كَانُوا مِنْ قَبْلَ لَفِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ, and before that truly they were lost. When we talk about Islam, let's keep the ayah in mind, we'll come back to it. But when we talk about Islam, what is the main message of Islam that strikes us? What was the message of النبي الأعظم صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم? And by the way, when you hear the name of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وعلى وسلم, it's okay to say it loudly. يعني اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله. It actually helps purifies our souls while we're sitting, as you all know, and this is much better than all the talk that we're talking about anyway. So what was the message when we talk about the message of الحبيب الأعظم صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وآله? To perfect the human being. That perfection. To go the extra mile. To go to the higher notch. When we talk about Islam and the message of Islam, there is an ayah in the Quran al-Kareem, and all of you know, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ إِنَّا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ ذَكَرٍ وَأُنْثَى. O people, this is for everyone, Muslim, not Muslim, black, white, yellow, red, whoever you are. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ, O people, O human beings, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, إِنَّا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ ذَكَرٍ وَأُنْثَى, we have created you, made you from males and females. وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلٍ, and we have made you into tribes and nations. لِتَعَارَفُوا, so you can get to know each other, or you can get to know. إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ, the most honorable amongst you, أتقاكم, is the one who has the highest piety. تقوى, we call it in the Arabic language, تقوى. So we have been created from males, females, nations, tribes, made into nations and tribes. So we get to know, what do we get to know, يا الله, لتعارفوا, إن أكرمكم عند الله أتقاكم. I hope that you're making the connection. The ayah is not separate. The ayah is really connected. Who is the one who has the most taqwa among the ummah of the Prophet? Among the human beings, who is the one who has the highest piety? النبي محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. We have been created from males and females and made into tribes and nations. So we get to know the one who has the most taqwa. And who is the one who has the most taqwa except محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم. Things are not loose. No, they're connected, but we have to go a little bit deep. But when we talk about piety or taqwa, we struggle sometimes. And even when you go into the academic area and you see definitions of taqwa, you'll see some people say it's the fear of being God-fearing, fearing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being this practicing after knowledge. Huh? So many definitions for taqwa. But when you go then and find the best definition of taqwa, you'll find it in the book of Allah. You'll find it in the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I did not find anything better than the hadith of Bukhari, which all of you know. Hadith Jibreel. When Jibreel comes to an-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he says, Ya Rasulullah, what is Islam? Tells him what is Islam. What is Iman? Tells him what Iman is. And then he tells him, what is Ihsan? He tells him, Ihsan is that you worship Allah as if you were seeing Him, though you do not see Him, but He surely sees you. Wow. That you worship the Creator and you're present. Your heart is present, knowing that He sees you. Though you don't see Him, but He sees you. I think if we take this definition of Ihsan, and we look at it from the taqwa standpoint, we find that the one who has taqwa, the true taqwa means what? Ihsan. If you have true taqwa, piety, it seems like you would have to be worshipping Allah as if you are seeing Him, though you do not see Him, but He sees you. Why does that make a difference? The ulama of suluk, they call this muraqabah. And it's essential on the path. If you have no muraqabah, what is muraqabah? Observing. Allah sees you. Allah is close to you. But the point is, are you close to Him? وَنَحْنُ أَقَرَبُ إِلَيْهِ مِنْكُمْ. We are closer to Him, the meaning, than you are. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is close to us, but the point is, where are we? Is our alertness, do we have our observation, is it on or is it off? So we don't realize. There is no observation. There is no muraqabah. There is no ihsan. And the problem with lack of ihsan, sometimes it renders the deed void, empty. Because the core of the deed that you do, ihsan means doing good. Sahih? When you do something good, you are muhsin. Those people whose names is muhsin, it means they do good. And Islam's concept is ihsan, which means doing good. Doing good, what it entails, there's a condition for doing good. Doing good, knowing that Allah is observing you. Therefore, in the Quran, you open up the Quran, you see many ayahs. وَأَحْسِنُوا. Do ihsan. Allah يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. Allah loves those who are muhsins. That you worship Allah as if you're seeing Him, though you don't see Him, but He sees you. More. هَلْ جَزَاءُ الْإِحْسَانِ إِلَّا الْإِحْسَانِ. When someone does you good, isn't it at least your obligation to do good? And that means the ayah is telling us, if you're good to those who are good to you, then what good are you? هَلْ جَزَاءُ الْإِحْسَانِ إِلَّا الْإِحْسَانِ. If you're good to those who are good to you, what good are you? What? Islam talks about ihsan. Transparency, ihsan. Worshipping the Creator that as if you're seeing Him, that makes you transparent. What does that mean? It makes you in, the in and the out is the same. There's no difference. What your tongue says is confirmatory to what your heart believes. Transparency, clear. Ihsan. So therefore, if someone does you good, the minimum is that you do good back. Allah fil ayah, and this ayah is telling us, لَقَدْ مَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Allah gave the believers the best of favors, the best of gifts. Manna. It's a favor. What is this favor, Ya Allah? What is this favor that you've given us? Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. We have not sent you but a mercy to the whole creation, the meaning of the ayah. إِذْ بَعَثَ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ. He sent them a messenger from amongst themselves. You know, we talk about the message of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam and how sometimes we do injustice to the message of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. And the whole point that I want to remind myself and you is, where is ihsan in our life? Where is ihsan in our dealings? Observing the Creator as if we were seeing Him, though we don't see Him, but He sees us. Because for Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to show us this ihsan, and he was Sayyidul Muhsineen sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But Al-Quran also came to tell us a little bit more. Tell us a little bit more about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we believe that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a human being. Al-Busiri rahimahullah mentioned, as you all know, فَمَبْلَغُ الْعِلْمِ فِيهِ أَنَّهُ بَشَرٌ وَأَنَّهُ خَيْرُ خَلْقِ اللَّهِ كُلِّهِمِ. The extent of our knowledge in him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he is a human being, yet he is the best of the creation, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But what is so important about the personality of Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that was sent as a mercy to everything, to the trees, to the skies, to heavens, to earth, to the birds, to human being, regardless of creed, he is there, he is a mercy to them. Regardless of background, he is a mercy to them. Islam came to teach us something, that we affirm dignity for every human, for every creation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created, and that is because Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam is a mercy for everything. Salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi wa alayhi. So much that many of the ulama go to say that Nabi, and rightfully so, that the messenger of the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a mercy to the malaika themselves. للعالمين. Everything. Al-Quran wants us to know who is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because you know, before we can say, pledge allegiance and say, yeah, we are followers of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Al-Quran wants us to know who is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that we are following. Who is this great personality that came? Who is this beauty that shined on this world? Oftentimes the scholars of Suluk, they say, you know, when people have a problem with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam not having a shadow, sometimes people say, you know, how come he went to that trip, that journey, and didn't have a shadow? Some of the understanding of this is that who gives things a shadow? The sun. And in the night, obviously, there are no shadows. But when there is a sunshine on an entity, it gives it a shadow. But then the ulama of Suluk and the ulama of spirituality looked and said, contemplated and said, well, who has the most nur, the sun or Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? It turns out that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is much more nurari than the sun and the entire solar system for that. He is the one that actually gives the sun its shadow. قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ نُورٌ وَكِتَابٌ مُبِينٌ. Many of the scholars meant to say that النور was النبي الأعظم صلى الله عليه وسلم, والكتاب المبين was also النبي الأعظم صلى الله عليه وسلم, for he was a walking Quran صلى الله عليه وسلم. That's no wonder, you all know that. عائشة رضي الله عنها أم المؤمنين, when she was asked the hadith known, how was the morality, how was the ethics of رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, she told them كان خلقه القرآن. His morality, his life, his CV was Al-Quran. If you want to know about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was a walking Quran sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. For he was Al-Quran al-Natiq sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alayhi. When we talk about Al-Nabi al-A'zam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we don't want to fall in the trap of those who consider, who stripped him from everything else and said he's only a delivery man. We have to be careful, because Allah did not tell us he was only a delivery man. Allah ordered us, وَتُعَزِّرُوهُ وتوقروه. So we do glorification and we beautiful, because he is beauty sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Actually when we look at him, we take our beauty from his beauty. We take our nur from his nur sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Al-Busiri mentions this. وَكُلُّهُمْ مِنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ مُلْتَمِسٌ. Everyone is taking from him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They're all taking from him. It's like the land that is hungry and thirsty for water. Some land is ready and some land is still rocky. And the rocky land usually does not use water very well. But we want, Islam wants us, wants our hearts to be open. When we talk about the azama of an-Nabi al-A'zam sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, really we cannot start. Where do we start? Where do we start and where do we end? It's an ocean that has no beginning, and has, in a sense, that where do we go? What do we do? If every ayah in the Quran from Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, all the way to Surah An-Nas talks about his glorification, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. But so we understand, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرَكَ. We have elevated your dhikr. You see, what do you mean? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's mention has been elevated? Yeah. Ask Hassan bin Thabit. Ask Hassan. أَلَمْ تَرَ أَنَّ اللَّهَ أَرْسَلَ عَبْدَهُ. Haven't you seen that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent his messenger, his worshipper, بِنُورِهِ, with the nur, with the guidance, وَاللَّهُ أَعَزُّ وَأَمْجَدُ. And Allah is above being attributed with what the anthropomorphist and what people attribute him with. نَبِيٌّ عَلَيْهِ مِنَ النُّبُوَّةِ خَاتَمٌ. A Nabi that has the seal of prophecy on him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. مِنَ اللَّهِ يَلُوحُ وَيَشْهَدُ. From Allah, and it shines and it gives its glory to people. It brings people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then more than that, وَضَمْ مَا الْإِلَهُ اسْمَ النَّبِيِّ إِلَى اسْمِهِ إِذْ قَالَ فِي الْخَمْسِ الْمُؤَذِّنُ أَشْهَدُ. Allah put the name of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam after his name. Five times when the muadhin says, أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ, he has to say, وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ وَشَقَّ لَهُ من اسمه ليجله فذو العرش محمود وهذا محمد. And he gave him a name that has similarity in its superficial meaning, in a sense that Allah al-Mahmud and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the praised Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we understand who is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and that's why then we understand how much we are short of trying to emulate him, of trying to follow his footsteps sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. When we see, Al-Quran wants us to see who was Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Therefore, if al-Isra' wal-Mi'raj, what happens? The Anbiya are gathered. The Anbiya from Adam alayhi salam all the way to Sayyidina Isa, and after that, all of them are there praying behind An-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam. Jumi'a lahu al-Anbiya salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi wa sallam. What is this for? So you can see who is Muhammadun Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Isa alayhi salam, Jesus, Sayyidina Isa. Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam, he knows him 600 years before Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent. Not only knows about him, la, he goes and tells people, gives them the good tidings. There will be a messenger after me. وَمُبَشِّرًا بِرَسُولٍ. Al-Quran mentions, وَمُبَشِّرًا بِرَسُولٍ يَأْتِي مِن بَعْدِي اسْمُهُ أَحْمَدٍ. I am giving you the good news, people. Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam, going to people, this is how happy he was. Not only he was waiting, he was happy, and he's going to them, giving them the good tidings. There's good news. There will be a messenger after me. His name is Ahmad. Sallallahu ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. But out of that, so we don't say, oh, you know, he's out of the glorification of Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam to our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Is that it? La. At the end of times, when Sayyidina Isa, we believe Sayyidina Isa is alive and he will come at the end of the time. And at the end of times, when Sayyidina Isa, وَهُوَ نَبِيٌّ مُرْسَلٌ, and he is Nabi, Rasul, from Ulil Azm, the highest level of Anbiya, Nabi, then Rasul, and then Ulil Azm. Oh, huh? the special of the special of the special of the Anbiya, Sayyidina Isa, at the end of times, out of loving Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Let's learn loving Rasulullah from Sayyidina Isa. وَمُبَشِّرًا بِرَسُولًا. What is the good news? Do we talk about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as our good news? But not only that, Isa alayhi salam, when the whole lot of all the people are there, and they say, you are Nabim Rasul, please lead the salah. He says, no, I do not want to lead. And there is a grandson, not Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself, la, a grandson of Rasulullah al-Mahdi alayhi salam, no, I will not lead the salah. And there is a grandson from Muhammad, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he leads, and I become muqtadi with him. So we understand when an-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam tells us things, the extent of these things. Let me take you to Umar radiallahu anhu, Sayyidina Umar Farooq. The hadith you all of you know. Hadith sahih. لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى أكون أحب إليه من ماله ونفس ووالد ونفسه ووالده وولده والناس أجمعين. That one of you will not be a believer until I am more beloved to him. يعني will not be a complete believer. His iman is not complete until I am more beloved to him than himself and his money and the whole people. Until him, الصوفية رضي الله عنهم, they call this فناء. That you don't see yourself anymore because all what you're thinking about is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How do I follow his footsteps? How can I do what he was doing? How can I eat the way he used to eat? Even eating that date that we eat in Ramadan. But when you eat that date, the date is good for you because it has no fat, by the way. Yani, it's good. It has carbohydrates, but it has no fat. But when you eat that date and you put it in your mouth, you feel the sweetness of the date. But I'm not talking about the sweetness of carbohydrates, C6H12O6. I am talking about the sweetness of following the sunnah of Al-Habib, the beloved to you, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For when you put that date, you ought to feel the sweetness of following the footsteps of someone you love. And you do it because you love him. You feel your connection with him. I am not bringing this from my pocket. An-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that. Hadith al-Bukhari, ذَاقَ حَلَاوَةَ الْإِيمَانِ. Al-Hadith says, ذاق means tasted. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not say felt, sha'ar. No. You will taste it literally. The sweetness of iman. When you accept the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in your life. When you make him your role model. One day, one of those days, Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu was walking with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, took the hand of Sayyidina Umar. And you know how Umar was radiallahu anhu. Yeah, shaitan comes one way. If Umar radiallahu anhu goes this way, shaitan goes the other way. Conflict of interest. Radwanullahi ta'ala alayhi wa ala sahaba ajma'in. Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu, the tough man, raised in the desert. Drank the milk of the desert. There was no Cerelac back then. No Cerelac and no baby formula. The baby formula was from the camels. Now, rough upbringing. What is in the desert? There is the sky and the sand, that's it. At night it's cold and during the day it's very hot. In that kind of environment, that kind of environment brings people who are rough. لكن عمر رضي الله عنه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم took his hand and they're walking. Look at this. Rasulullah, the best of the creation, the one who tells him, one, don't walk behind me because the malaika are walking behind me. Leave that space for the malaika. Look at that. He walks with Sayyidina Umar. There's no... Look at the humbleness of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. But look at Sayyidina Umar, that rough man, what happened? Look at the transformation. Umar radiallahu anhu, he says, Ya Rasulullah, Wallahi, I love you. I love you. We're saying this is normal. Yeah, sure, why not? Because if we ask everybody, yeah, well, of course we love him. Really. Sayyidina Umar said what he meant. It takes a lot to come and say, I love you. I love you, Ya Rasulullah. It's not an easy decision. It is not something that comes like this. La, love is so profound. But Umar radiallahu anhu realized that this deen is about love of Allah and His Prophet. He says, Ya Rasulullah, I love you. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, said, more akthar min malik, more than your money, Ya Umar? Sayyidina Umar said, Naam, Ya Rasulullah. Again, we're saying, yeah, I love you more, my money. Things to contemplate about. Because Umar radiallahu anhu is trying to teach us that saying I love you is not about words, because what we say here, actions speak louder than words. Don't tell me I love you, and then when it comes to spend in my path, you think, no, you want to hold it. Notice there are many things. Naam, actions. Umar radiallahu anhu said, Naam, Ya Rasulullah, more than money. More than your family, Naam, Ya Rasulullah, more. You are prioritized more than my family. And then Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ya Umar, more than yourself? Sayyidina Umar said, La, Ya Rasulullah, not more than myself. And again, we think, oh, how come if I was there, I would have said that, really. Think about this. Sayyidina Umar was truthful. What was inside was reflected on the outside. The priority of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not below number 2, number 3, number 4, number 5, wherever it is, we put the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on our priority list. Where is he in our daily priority list? To Umar radiallahu anhu, he was number 2. The huquq of Rasulullah is number 2. We have to learn. Honest answer. It's an honest answer. Truthful answer. Ya Rasulullah, yes, but not more than myself. There's a narration that says, Laysa ba'd, Ya Umar. Not yet, Ya Umar. Still, there's still more. Some narration says, some scholar says that Sayyidina Umar went out, thought about this, and then came back in the masjid, said, Ya Rasulullah, by Allah, I love you more than I love myself. He says, Al-ana, Ya Umar. Now, your iman has been perfected, Ya Umar. Because we don't ought not to see ourselves. Today we're here, tomorrow we're gone. Today we're here, tomorrow we're going to go. Just like everybody else before us is gone. What have we left? What good have we done? How positively did we contribute to our society, to our community, to our society, to our nation, to our world? What did we do? Some narrations, they say, Sayyidina Umar was asked, said, Ya Umar, how did you turn so that you love him more than you love even yourself? And Sayyidina Umar said this, let's learn from Umar, radiallahu anhu. He said, I looked, I contemplated. And then I realized that my need for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam is much bigger than my need for myself. For me, myself will not be the one who would give intercession and shafa'ah on the day of judgment. But loving him would give me the intercession in the day of judgment. For loving myself would not make me be raised to the highest of ranks. But loving him would make me raised to the highest of ranks in paradise. For if loving myself would not make me do all these good things, but loving him would make me do all these good things. He taught me how to be generous. He taught me how to forgive. He taught me how to be decent. He taught me how to be caring. He taught me how to be kind. My need for him is much more and much more symbolized and much more significant than my need for myself. Therefore, I definitely love him for more than I love myself. A love. As-Sahaba radiallahu anhum wa ahlul bayt, they manifested a love, because our deen, our religion is about love, unlike the popular opinion. But our religion is about love. It's about love. As-Sahaba wa Ahl-Bayt, they realized this. And they were dealing with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on that basis. Let's take the example of the tree. The tree that al-Bukhari narrated and others. Hadith Sahih. And Nabi, oh, you all know the event, but let's see what happened. The tree, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to give khitab and his speech with a tree next to him. But then as-sahaba radiallahu anhu said, Ya Rasulullah, will build for you three steps so you can stand, so al-ba'id yarak, so the people that are far away can see you. So that the tree was a little bit far away from him. The next Friday when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was giving the khutbah, every single sahabi that was sitting in that big masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was hearing that tree crying like a little boy cries, crying and weeping with sound and movement, so much that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam interrupted his speech to go down and hold that tree and pat on it and telling it, aren't you satisfied that you will be buried here in this spot and you will be resurrected with me in the day of judgment? As sahaba said, that's when the tree calmed down, just like the boy, little boy calms down when you give him the milk. What kind of love that makes trees speak? A love that makes rocks talk. Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib, Mawla al-Muwahideen. Man kuntu mawla, فهذا علي مولاه. حديث متواتر. So, مولى الموحدين أمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب إمام أهل الحقائق. حديث في الحاكم. الحاكم narrates حديث. Look at this حديث. He says, I went with Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم one day from Mecca. We were in Mecca. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as you all know, he used to go to the cave and on the mountains of Mecca. One time he took with him Ali ibn Abi Talib. Sayyidina Ali is narrating the hadith. He says, Wallah, by Allah, every single rock and stone of that mountain as we were passing it, passing through it, but said, Assalamu alayka ya Rasulallah. Peace and blessings be upon you, ya Rasulullah. A love that the stones could not just be silent watching Rasulullah pass in front of them, but they had to give their greetings and their salam and express their love by saying, Assalamu alayka, ya Rasulullah. And sometimes you see people whose hearts are even worse than the rocks and the mention of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is in front of them, and they don't even go to say, Assalamu alayka, ya Rasulullah. A love that makes stones speak. But not only that, I know we don't have much time. Not only that, love that makes other things speak, but his love towards us. Does he love us? Yes. You and me? Yes. Does he care about you and me? Yes. But he was 1400 and some years ago. He is Hayy. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's alive, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Fi alam al-barzakh. Is alam. People think al-barzakh is like dead. We don't, in Islam, we don't believe in annihilation. You go from alam al-dunya, which has its own dimension, the worldly life. You go to alam al-barzakh, it has its own dimensions. Forget about the laws of physics. Laws of physics apply today. But you all know in your dreams, when you dream, you're sitting right here in Phoenix, Arizona, and all of a sudden you dream, it takes you at night, you go to Mecca. What happens to the distance and time? And you experience and you walk a split second. Forget about that. Huh? It's a window to Alam al-Barzakh telling you what the world of souls experience. Huh? So that's why some people who object on the Sufiyya radiallahu anhum, they haven't really understand where they come from because they haven't even dreamt yet. Or maybe if they haven't dreamt, they haven't recorded their dreams. But you know why? It's because even when we go to bed, we are so occupied by materialism. So even that when we put our head on that pillow trying to sleep, millions of thoughts are racing through our minds. What do I do this? Microprocessors are working all the time, overtime. And you sleep out of exhaustion, not out of mental clarity. We have to think about أَلَا إِنَّ أَوْلِيَاءَ اللَّهِ لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. They are with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are detached and attached. Takhalli and tahalli, right? Detached from the dunya, attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Attached to want to please Allah, being with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Spending time one on one, like we say now, huh? You and your beloved at night. You and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tell him what you want. He knows, but he wants you to speak. Tell him. He wants you to pray for him. He wants you to repent. He wants us to come close and open our hearts. الحديث الإمام السيوطي حسن. In fact, there is one narrator, it's called محتسب أبو عائد. He is weak, لكن ابن حبان وثقه. يعني ابن حبان made it, authenticated him. وباقي السند, the rest of the سند of the حديث الصحيح. رجاله رجال الحديث الصحيح يعني. الحديث says this, look at the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Listen to him telling us that he has a yearning for us. شوق. Yearning, he wants to see us. He wants us. He wants to know us. He says, وَدَدْتُ. Hadith says, وَدَدْتُ لَوْ أَنِّي لَقِيتُ إِخْوَانِي. I wish that I was with my brothers. As-Sahaba radiallahu anhum say, أَلَسْنَا إِخْوَانُكَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. Aren't we your brothers, يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ? He says, no. أَنْتُمْ أَصْحَابِي. You are my companions. But my brothers are those who come after you and they believe in me without seeing me. I wish that I was with them. I wish that I see them. صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم. Look at this. لقد جاءكم رسول من أنفسكم. عزيز عليه ما عنتم. It's dear for him. The hardships you go through. Even now. It's dear. حريص عليكم. He is caring about you. He is merciful on you. He wants things to happen. Good things to happen to you. As if he wished he was there just to take your hand and lead you. And you can allow that to happen if you submit yourself to Allah and His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam. Because for the sunnah is trying to take you to him salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi wa alihi. But there is another hadith very similar. Ibn Asakir narrated this hadith عن البراء. الحديث فيه ضعف. Hadith has weakness. But the general meaning, I believe, is correct, and it sort of coincides with the first one. Let's look at this narration. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَدَدْتُ. وَدَدْتُ, I wish that I have seen my brothers. And the same, they said, aren't we your brothers, Ya Rasulullah? He said, no, my brothers are those who come after you, and they believe with me, and they haven't seen me. And then the hadith continues to say, Ya Aba Bakr. He's telling Abu Bakr, radiallahu anhu, Ya Aba Bakr. Oh, Abu Bakr, how about people who come after you, يعني long, long time after you, they love you because they heard that you love me. Ya Allah. فَأَحِبَّهُمْ. So you love them, may Allah love them. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is making dua. Abu Bakr, people will come after you, they love you, they don't know you, but they love you simply because they heard that you love me, so love them, may Allah love them. This deen is about love. But not false love. Actions speak louder than words. I'll finish with this. And there's a lot to talk about Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. We can, and the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is like an oasis of nur, that you go from one, you go to the other, and you're drinking from the ocean of the ma'rifah, and the ocean of the nur, and the ocean of knowledge and ilm from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and you're taking pharmacological dosage from the pharmacy of Muhammadun Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Forget about the biochemistry. I'm not saying it's insignificant. I have physicians here, they will be upset. But there is another biochemistry. There is a spiritual biochemistry. There is a spiritual biochemistry. By Allah, there is a spiritual biochemistry that heals all and reverses all kinds of biochemical reaction. You just have to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you just have to submit yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you will see all these things, that you will experience Him. ذَاقَ حَلَاوَةَ الْإِيمَانِ. You will taste the sweetness of Iman. But are we going to let ourselves, or we're going to, we think that we will manage better. We think that. There are signs. Let's finish up with signs. Signs for the real love. Three signs let's talk about today. If you really love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if you love that mercy to that, to the universe, are you a mercy to the universe? But there are three signs. Number one, كَثْرَةُ الصَّلَاةِ عَلَيْهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلَهِ. How many times do you make salah and salam on him per day? Everyone knows that to themselves. 100? 200? 1,000? How many times? How many times? Actions speak louder than words. You say, I love you, but then you don't mention him. You don't think about him. You don't learn his way. You don't emulate him. You don't try to follow his footsteps. Then we're lying to ourselves. That's false love. How many times? Thousands. Thousands? Thousands. How much do you want? How close do you want to be to him? Is the question. How close do you want to be? If you want to be close, then your numbers are up. And if you really say, I love you with my mouth and the heart is away, then you know, we don't think about him. We always turn the TV and we always turn all these things and everything else and we make a preparation for all kinds of stuff. How about making a preparation one night to celebrate and commemorate the birth of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in our own homes? In the home. Telling your children about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How was he playing with the children? How the children, 4 or 5 years old, manifested such love for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So much that the little girls of Bani Najjar, the little girls of Medina, they would go, while they're playing their own games, they would sing songs praising Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because you know why? Because as they say in biology, a human being is a product of his environment. Because the environment, every day they hear the name Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They hear Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So even the kids then, when they are 3, 4, 5, 6 years old and they can speak, what comes on their mouth is what they have been fed. They have been fed the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's why their whole life is about the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Don't expect that you're going to feed them everything else and they're going to come to be عاشقين of النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. The poet said this. The poet said, it's okay to share with you. I'll take a few more minutes. He says, لا عذب الله أمي. The poet is praying for his mother, and we all ought to pray for our mothers and our fathers. And not only our biological fathers, our spiritual fathers. Sheikh Muhammad Masoom Naqshbandi rahmatullahi alayhi is like a spiritual father for all of us. Many of the awliya and the ulama that passed away, they're our spiritual. They have huquq on me and you. They have huquq. Our parents who passed away, if your parents passed away, may Allah have mercy on them. If they haven't, you have the Jannah is there between your hands. Go and serve them. But if they passed away, do not neglect them. Because when they were alive, they surely did not neglect you. They were thinking about you, not only thinking with words, with action. They stood up the nights. They took you to the hospital when you were sick. When you were not feeling good, they were not feeling good. When you were hungry, they couldn't even taste food. Food was tasteless when you were sick and not feeling well. They have rights upon you. When they pass away, do not neglect them like that. For this is a bad morality and bad company and bad ethics on your behalf. Because if you do this, you know what comes around goes around. Then they will, your children will also forget about you the minute you pass. If you don't want to think about it from a spiritual point of view, think about it from a selfish point of view. For right now. But we want to take the higher end. May Allah have mercy on our grandfathers and grandmothers. Those who put so much, they mix their blood with the food so we can eat. Yani, metaphorically speaking, they spend their blood so we can be raised. Their efforts day and the night. We should not be a sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The way of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is that we are not ungrateful. Remember what I started saying, if you're good to those who are good to you, then what good are you? Well, those were among the best to you. So how are you repaying them? ذِكْرُهُ sallallahu alaihi wa alihi. Mentioning him. You hear his name, your heart moves. You hear his seerah, it's like the paradise, an ocean of paradise is opening on you. Illumination is pouring into your heart. لأنه his name is شفاء صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم. His name. Say يا محمد. When he say يا محمد and something is in حديث ابن عمر, you all know. Name محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. The ملائكة will start writing. Number two, following his sunnah. Not replacing it by our ways. No, my way is better. People don't say my way is better. But they practice it. He knows the haqiqah. And if he knows, you submit to those who know. We're not saying disable your mind. La, al-Islam does not believe in Islam. We do not say it's simply a matter of faith. La, it's a matter of faith and it's a matter of fact. The last sign of you loving Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the yearning to go do ziyarah, visit him. That so much that you do not sit still. If there is an opportunity for you to go and do ziyarah, to stand in front of him sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, to say your salam on him, to be in his hadra sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam. Huh? But then when you want to go, I always say that, do not be religious tourists who take mental pictures, even if without a camera. They stay and look at the arch, mashallah, great arch, mashallah, great pillars. If you're going there for the pillars and the arches, yeah, go ahead, take pictures. Huh? There are three kinds of people. They say there are people that watch things happen and people that make things happen. Don't be among those who watch things. Be among those that make things. But there's a third kind that don't know what happened. They go and they take mental pictures. You're going there to take mental pictures? Or you're going there so you can sharpen your spirituality and abandon yourself. So you can be in that massive spiritual atmosphere, overwhelming nurani environment that takes you from this materialism to spirituality and illumination and enlightenment. That you stand in front of the beloved sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, knowing that he is pleased with you. He knows who you are. And he returns your salam. And he is pleased with you standing in front of him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When you say assalamu alayka ya sayyidi ya rasulallah, he knows, he returns your salam, that he is pleased with you. You have done well, you have been a good person, I am pleased with you. Bring pleasure to the heart of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When we help each other, when we serve his ummah, we bring pleasure to his heart sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam. When you are good and you give, you are giving, you bring pleasure. So let's try to do these things. It's not about talk, and I'll finish my talk here. It's more about action. What are we going to do today different than we've done yesterday? How positive are we going to be in our family, with our friends, with our society, with our community, with our world? And when you do things, random acts of kindness. The hadith of Bukhari, the man gave a dog in the desert that was lost. The man went and gave him some water. Because he went all the way and he struggled to get the water for a thirsty dog, Allah forgave his sins and let him enter Jannah, paradise. Random acts of kindness. That's what Islam wants us to do. And when people ask you, when you're doing these good things to Muslims and non-Muslims, you're always good. When they ask you, why are you doing this, tell them, because you follow the message of Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is what he taught us to be. I ask Allah for me and you tawfiq to follow the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's path. To bring love into our hearts, to purify our hearts so we have mercy for all and malice for none. So we can be free from materialism and materialistic things in our heart, so our soul can be elevated. Maybe then we'll see the nur of the ma'rifah, the nur of knowledge, and the nur of mahabbah. For he or she that does not have love in their hearts, have lost a great deal. And unfortunately, one only realizes this after it's too late. So I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who listen. يَسْتَمِعُونَ الْقَوْلَ فَيَتَّبِعُونَ أَحْسَنَ. They listen to things and they take the best out of it. Whatever I said is inshallah by the tawfiq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Thank you for listening to me. May Allah bless those organizers who organize these events to commemorate the birth of the best of the creation sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Bring people with you next time. Tell people about Muhammad and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Open up campaigns. You don't have to have an organized structure. Just go do random good things to people and tell them, I'm doing this because my Prophet is Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Smile, put a smile on your face, and when you smile, tell them, I smile because he taught us to smile, because this is the message of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When people transgress upon your rights, forgive them. And the reason you forgive them, even if they're not worthy of forgiving, but you are worthy of forgiving because you follow the message of Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.